Hello, everybody. I am the narrator. Oh, come on! Give it up for the narrator! Oh, fine. Be like that, then. Our story takes place on the Dark Railway today, where there are lots of locomotives happily getting on with their work. They're all as happy as can be, especially the three big engines who live at the junction. Their names are Dave, Brian and Raymond, and they... Oh, bugger off, narrator. I'm trying to sleep here. You're ruining our introduction. Fine, be like that. I'll just go and cook myself an omelette or something until you threw off the screen. Toodles. So, is there anything interesting happening today, Brian? I don't know. I don't write the scripts. I thought Dark DJ let you help him out with this one. No, he just asked me questions about my past, you know, when I was built. How my early life was, if I had any siblings, that kind of thing. Well, why didn't he ask me? Why didn't you ask him? Oh, okay. Dark DJ, why didn't you ask me about my past? Because it's not a crucial plot point for the film! That's so unfair. Why does Brian get questioned? I have plenty of interesting things to say. You're ruining the opening scene with your incessant talking. Shut up and let me go on with the production of the rest of this film. And I don't see Raymond complaining. Hey! Don't drag me into this. I don't really care as long as we all star in the film. Anyway, I'm going back to sleep. Same here. Night. But it's 4 in the after. The next morning, the three engines awoke, yawning and lazily grinning at each other as the sun rose over the sheds. Well, guys, what shall we do today? Why don't we wait around and see if this film will eventually gain a plot?
I agree with Brian.
And so, they waited and waited all morning for a plot device to mysteriously expose itself to them, which it didn't. Dave was getting impatient. Oh, Christ, can we do something yet? I know I love sitting around and doing nothing, but this in taking the... What's that noise? Brian looked out of the sheds. Oh, dear God! It can't be! Not... Oh... He stopped speaking, as yet another standard 4MT tank rolled into the sheds, with the number 80011 on his smoke box. The new arrival grinned at Brian, who grimaced back.
Brian, long time no see.
Low brain. Why are you here? I thought you were at a sci-fi convention.
I was, but your manager asked me to come over and help you out, big brother.
But we don't need any help.
Oh yes, you do.
We don't!
You do.
We don't! Oh, shut up, will you? Sorry. So what exactly can you do, Brain?
Me? I can do absolutely anything. I am Brain, the most intelligent engine in existence. I, the greatest mathematician the world has ever seen. I, who has won hundreds and thousands of awards for my contributions to science. I, who can do viciously complex sums in just seconds.
Alright. Can you just go and shunt my next train together, please?
Sure thing.
So that's why Dark DJ asked you about your past. He brought your snot-nosed little brother into the film. Why? I don't know. Shall we just see how this pans out? I want to get back to sleep. As do I. Good night. But... The next morning, Brain left the yard and ventured to Mirkum, where he found Owen, Ryan, and Alan shunting in the yards.
Hello there.
Hello?
Say, did you know that I have won 17 Nobel Peace Prizes?
No.
Or that I am fluent in over 75 languages?
Or
that I...
Look, mate, can you just take this train for us, please?
Oh, right then.
And he trundled away, disheartened. He then proceeded to Soma with the goods train, where he found the line's privately owned tank engine twins, Theo and Otto, deep in conversation. They immediately stopped talking as the engine approached. Oh, Brian, there you are.
I'm Brain, the most...
Can you just drop off those vans there, please? Thank you.
Fine, I won't tell anyone about all my amazing achievements or my immense brain power.
Brain power? You thinking what I'm thinking? That we should host some sort of massive party and get absolutely slammed? No! That he would be perfect candidate for our top secret plan! Oh, I wasn't thinking about that, but yeah, he could be perfect. You have no idea what I'm on about, do you? No. Oh, wait, yes, yes, the secret plan. Oh, yes, Otto, we have our first test subject.
Wakey, wakey. Come on, Brian, wake up.
Brain, it's 5 a.m. Go back to sleep.
But I can't sleep.
Well, I can, so shut up and go back to sleep.
Brian, wake up.
Is it 7 o'clock yet?
No, it's 5:20.
Brain, for Christ's sake, go back to sleep. I've had enough of this. For the last 5 days, all you've done is wake us up early in the morning to go on and on about all the prizes you've won and how brilliant you are. Just shut up! Who's shouting? I'm trying to sleep. Oh.
Well, Brian, it's not my fault I was blessed with intelligence that far outstrips your own. It's not my fault you're a boring layabout who's been drinking beer since he was 3 months old.
Why, you little piece of... Look, I can defuse this situation rather nicely. How? Brain, I have 2 work orders for you.
Fire away, dear Raymond.
It's paradox time. Right, your first order is to obey every command I give you.
Right.
And your second order is to disregard my first order.
But, you want me to do whatever you say, but not to? That doesn't make sense. I cannot comprehend what it is you need me to do. Do you need me to? I have to.
Oh my! What happened to him? Oh yeah, I forgot. He doesn't understand paradoxes.
Where am I?
Welcome!
To our lair.
Lair?
Yes. This is where we carry out our top secret plans, and you, our young friend, are going to assist us.
What do you mean?
We need you to do some calculations for us to advance our latest project.
And what if I refuse?
Well, you've not got a lot of choice, my friend, as we have taken a necessary precaution of removing your crew from your footplate. Now, we have decided to give you an ultimatum. You see that nice big deep ravine over there? Either you help us out, or you take a one-way trip into the abyss.
No, you can't do this. I refuse to cooperate. Release me at once. I am the most intelligent...
Exactly. You're the most intelligent engine we have ever met, making you essential to our plans. Think about it, Brain. If you help us, you will be world famous once we unveil our technology to the masses.
But I don't want to be. I can't.
Of course you can. Now get to work. We are counting on you.
Oh, all right. Well, fellas, I think that's all of them.
Ooh, excellent. Now, we shall just input them into our devices.
Is anybody going to tell me what exactly I've been doing all of this for?
Well, Brain, you see, we have been developing this technology for a long time. We just needed you to confirm our numbers were correct, and they all seem in order. Now, we are ready to test fire the machine.
What machine?
This one!
What the hell?!
This is our teleporter! It will allow us to transport matter from place to place with almost no effort from the engine. This will change the world! And now, it is ready for its first test subject!
Who's that?
You're an intelligent engine. Surely you know.
Me?
Of course. After annoying all of the other engines, we have decided that the best thing to do with you is send you on a long holiday, and this machine will make it happen.
You're mad, both of you. Let me out of here.
We can't do that. We have no idea if this thing works, and we are most unwilling to test it ourselves or on our friends. So, you are the perfect candidate. Come on, Brain. Your future awaits you.
No, no, no! Don't do this. What if I die? Or worse?
Oh, come on. You know perfectly well that this won't happen. Actually, Theodore, he might die. He might be deconstructed in the process, or get ripped apart by the sheer power of this machine.
Oh, please. Please, let me go. Let me go, I say.
Don't worry, Brain. If this test is successful, you are free to go.
Please! Please don't!
Fire up the machine, Theodore! Well, Brian, safe journey, eh? Goodbye! Do you think we should bring him back now? Yes, we must see whether he survived.
Oh dear Lord.
How was it?
The most awful experience of my life.
What happened?
I landed on an island, in the middle of nowhere, surrounded in fog. It was cold, a barren wasteland.
Were you hurt?
Not in the slightest.
Well, thank you very much, Brain, for helping us out, and becoming our first successful test subject. Well done!
Now that's over. Can I go home now, please?
No, I don't think so. Goodbye. Well, that worked well. Now, shall we get the device ready for our public unveiling? Indeed, Otto. Several weeks passed, and Theo and Otto were finally ready to unveil their machine to the general public. Sorry, by general public, I mean the other engines. The general public, it seems, were not interested in the tall tales of two whiny little tank engines. Oh, Otto! I'm so excited! Calm down, Theodore! Remember what your doctor said? Don't drink yellow water? No! That if you don't keep your boiler pressure under control, you could have a piston stroke! I don't remember being told that. Well, you were picking your nose at the time. Anyway, the twins were roused from their conversation, and the sound of steam locomotives and diesels echoed around Soma Valley. Otto grinned. And here comes our audience! Oh, Theo! This is going to be... Oh, for God's sake! Is this it? Where is everyone else? We expected everyone to come! Dave shuffled awkwardly, looking at the floor. Well, guys, Eddie and Colin had a bad shipment of coal, I'm afraid, and were too ill to come. Mr. Dark is stranded at Kolhapa. And Owen, Alan and Ryan are attending a diesel shunters convention at Slough. Theo stared at them. They couldn't be bothered to come, could they? Well, no they couldn't. Sorry. Well, that's disappointing. Oh well, you three are here. Let's get started. Now, do you three know why you are here? No. No, no. Well, follow us, and we shall show you. The twins straightened up, then burst into speech. Well, you see, we've been thinking long and hard about the railways of Britain today, and the various problems that have presented themselves over the years. Yes, for example, trains often run late, accidents happen, goods damaged, passengers complaining, etc., etc. It occurred to us that there must be a way to revolutionise rail transport in this country. And this machine is just what we need to do it. This machine can instantaneously transport engines, people, rolling stock and goods to faraway destinations in the blink of an eye. We will become rich and famous once we have proven this machine works and, well, It is the most ambitious project myself and Theodore have undertaken to date, and is the pinnacle of years of research and resource gathering. Heck, you three gave us some of the vital ingredients for all of this to be possible. When? Why, a few years back, when you three went to Radstock. Those vans contained more than hot dogs, rope and rusty rails, you know. There was also some paper clips, corrugated iron, some electrical cables, and a little bit of neurotoxin.
Neurotoxin?!
So anyway, do we actually have any proof this thing works? Well, I'm glad you asked. This is precisely why you three are here, to witness the public demonstration of our time-saving device. I shall be teleporting myself from one side of the complex to the other, using nothing more than this ingenious invention. Now, if you would like to start it up, my dear Otto, I shall assume the position. As Theo rolled into the strange-looking shed, Dave blurted out. It is safe, asked Dave, as the machine began to make a rather strange noise. Of course it is! But thank you for your concern, young David. Now please stand back, we are about to begin. Theo took his place in the shed, as Otto rolled into a button, starting up the machine, which began to crackle and fizzle. The twins seemed unconcerned, for a moment. Then, Theo suddenly screamed, as the entire facility began to rock and shake, and the crackling noises got louder. Otto! Something's gone wrong! Abort! Abort! I'm trying, but it won't stop! Ah! I'm coming, Theodore! Otto buffered up to his twin, who, shaking madly, began to sob. I don't feel right! Get me out, please! You three, help me! I say we run for it. No, we have to help them. Why? They're irritating old gits, and now they're going to blow themselves to pieces. But Brian, where will we get our free alcohol from now? Brian considered. Good point, come on! And the three engines charged at the twins, but as they approached, something very odd happened. Am I dead? Did those idiots level half of Kent? No, we did not! Ah! What have I told you guys about surprising me like that? What happened then?
It seems the teleporter malfunctioned.
Well, I'd already figured that out.
And we've been transported rather too far away from the dark railway for my liking. I think we're on XLMS metals.
How can you tell? Oh. Dave was staring around, looking horrified, as he drank more of the scenery in.
Guys, I think I might know where we are.
Well, spit it out, won't you?
It looks like, the Cecil and Carlisle line.
Are you sure?
The more I look, the more I'm certain. But how do you?
I worked here long ago, in the 1950s, before coming down to the railway. And But Dave was interrupted by a small stallion mogul that had bustled up to the group.
Hey, you lot, get back to work and stop gossiping in the sun. If there isn't enough work to do and... What the heck is that?
How very rude!
I've never seen anything like it. What are you? Where are you built? Who sent you?
It became clear to the engines that this mogul was either incredibly sharp or incredibly mad. No one sent me! We just, kind of arrived here. And for your information, I'm a BR Class 47, built at crew in 1958. Now, if you'll excuse us, we really must be...
1958, mate? You mad? It's 1953. You from the future, lad.
Theo and Otto suddenly exchanged nervous glances, and Dave noticed. 1953? That's insane. I mean,
we can't have just jumped through. There was a long silence. The mogul, feeling that he had made his point, promptly scurried away. Theo? Otto? You know you said that thing was a teleporter?
Yes.
Does it happen to do anything else? Well, don't fly off the handle at us, guys, but we have been trialing some hitherto untested modules for the machine, such as a way to cure diseases or cloning vital equipment. And there was one other teensy little experimental module that we might have installed just before we unveiled the machine.
Which was what?
Well, we wanted to experiment with delivering goods before they had even been ordered, so we added a time manipulating module to the machine to see if that worked. And, well, I think it does work. It was meant to take teleported things back in time by a few minutes only. We deactivated it, though. But it appears to have malfunctioned severely.
What? And taken us back to 1953?
Yes. So, we have not only travelled through space, but we have travelled through time! Yes. I see.
I'm going to kill the pair of you! Dave, calm down! You sent them back 10 years! What the hell were you thinking? It wasn't intentional! How the hell are we going to get home? Calm down! We'll think of something! But! I worked here in the 1950s! What if I,
Dave suddenly looked terrified.
Otto? What would happen if my past self saw me here? Oh, Dave, I wouldn't like to think, but we've got to think of a way to get back to the Sweet! I can scare the crap out of myself! At least something's gonna come out of this mess! Dave! Don't you see? If you do that, you'll cause a massive rip in the space-time continuum!
What?
You'll cause a paradox! You could cause utter chaos and break the fabric of existence if your past self recognises you for what you really are! We were lucky that that mogul thought us mad, but...
So I could potentially destroy the world?
Yes.
Sounds like a good price to pay to see look on my own face.
No! We must disguise you! Immediately! Before anyone recognises you! Brian! Find some black and white paint! And hurry up! Dave! Follow us!
So, Brian hurried away to find some paint. Ugh, God knows where he'll...
Oh look! He found 2 tankers of black and white paint! How about that?
Meanwhile, Dave, Theo and Otto were cosily huddled inside a small shed. So, why do we need paint?
Well, we have a plan to get us back to our own time and back to the Dark Railway, but it might take a while to fully implement. But in the meantime, we are going to renumber you and take off your nameplates.
My nameplates? How dare you?
Well, we need to rename you as well. Your nameplates would give you away instantly.
I guess that makes sense.
Anyway, we might be here a little while, so a completely fake identity might save us all.
Once Brian returned with his mysteriously found tankers of paint, Theo and Otto's driver set to work, painting over his old number of 45101 and replacing it with 45102?
What?
It's literally 1-digit difference! I demand another number!
Guys?
What? The idea of this plan was to give me a different number, right?
Yes.
Then why have you repainted 45101 on my sides?
Dave, we are little old tank engines. We forget easily. Come on then, back to the sheds.
44909?
Dave, please, tell me that you...
I love it!
Now satisfied with his new identity, Dave, Theo and Otto returned to the yard, where Brian and Raymond were waiting.
So, I'm correct in thinking that we are now stuck in 1953?
I just can't stress enough that we are stuck in 1953!
Yes, by the looks of it.
So, do we actually have a plan to set things right? I mean, I'm not even meant to exist for another 5 years!
Relax, Raymond. We have a plan to sort this all out. Basically, we must make another machine, capable of taking us back to the future, and back to the Dark Railway. For that, we will need several key items, including pure crystal, corrugated iron, some potatoes, electricity cables, oh, and of course, a teensy little vat of neurotoxin.
Neurotoxin?!
It is one of the most important ingredients. How the hell are we meant to find this stuff, eh? We'll find a way. We'd better refuel. Raymond sighed.
What's up?
As we really are in 1953, and as far as I'm aware, mass dieselization didn't occur until 1954, so how am I meant to refuel? I'm already almost out of diesel. Nobody answered.
I guess I'll have to hide somewhere then, until you guys have built the machine again. Motion passed! Don't worry, old friend. We shall tuck you safely away somewhere. Trust us. Finding these items and rebuilding a machine shouldn't take too long. I hope. When everybody had refueled, the engines hauled Raymond down the line, hoping to find an old and abandoned shed somewhere in which for him to hide. They eventually found one, after several near misses with the local engines. Now, sit tight, buddy! Ha ha, you're so amusing. I'll stand guard for you. If anyone asks, this shed is unsafe and scheduled for demolition. Well, we had better get started looking for the parts then. The sooner we find them, the sooner we can hopefully go home. Dave, Theo and Otto left, leaving Brian and Raymond to spark up a romance in the crumbling old shed. Seriously, narrator, you're getting on my nerves. Just get on with the story. Fine. The three engines soon arrived at Carlisle, where they found a nice empty little siding to get some rest.
You're not still annoyed at us about the machine malfunctioning, are you, Dave?
Dave remained silent.
Oh, come on! It'll be like a holiday! If I wanted a holiday, I'd have gone to Burnham-on-Sea! Not this wasteland! I want to go home, goddammit!
We will soon. We shall start the hunt tomorrow. And by we mean you.
Aren't you two going to help?
Of course not! We need to find a suitable place to rebuild the teleporter!
So, I'm expected to find these random parts all by myself?
No, we shall try and recruit some other engine to assist us with our search. Don't you worry, Dave, we're on top of this.
Dave wasn't entirely sure that they were.
Meanwhile, at the Love Shack, do you think we'll ever get home, Brian?
Oh, what? Sorry, spotted an excruciatingly attractive Jubilee roll past.
What are we saying? Will Theo and Otto get us home? I mean, back to the future?
Who knows? They managed to get us here. Maybe they can find a way to get us back.
Well, I hope they figure out a way soon. I'm very thirsty.
Well, maybe. Maybe I can find you some diesel fuel from somewhere. But
I'm not meant to exist until 1958. What if someone sees me?
That mogul saw you, and nothing bad's happened. I think he just thought we were mental. Anyway, what if we put out the story that you're an experimental prototype, sent here on trial? Then you can help us search for those ridiculous things. That could work.
Yeah, maybe. Brian?
Yup.
I'm scared.
Me too, Ray. Me too.
The following morning, everybody got up early. Feeling exceptionally groggy, Dave listened moodily as Theo and Otto outlined the first stage of their plan.
So, we think we might know where there is a decent set of siding to build a new machine. The first thing we want you to do, David, is to find us some metal pipes, corrugated iron, and 12 potatoes.
Why do we need potatoes?
They're good for you, my friend.
But what have they got to do with the machine?
We need electricity from somewhere, right? Have you never heard of a potato battery?
Dave didn't bother to ask anymore. Instead, he bade farewell to the twins as he headed off into a nearby yard to begin his search. Raymond awoke feeling very sick indeed. He felt very thirsty and tired. Brian, however, was feeling optimistic this morning.
They have to have some diesel fuel somewhere around here.
Doubt it.
Well, I'll be off in a minute, honey. Now make sure you vacuum around the place and have tea ready for 5 o'clock sharp. Ha ha! Seriously, mate, it won't be long, trust me. I'll see if I can find the others while I'm at it. And with that, he puffed away, leaving Raymond to ponder what exactly Brian meant by vacuum. Meanwhile, back at Carlisle, Dave had set to work combing the sidings in the area for the ingredients that the twins required. Where the hell am I meant to find potatoes? A farm, his driver suggested. Well, what are we looking around in sidings for then? It seemed foolish not to check. You're a complete genius. Oh, thanks, Dave. I was being sarcastic. Slowly but surely, Dave rolled through various yards around Carlisle Station, hoping above hope that he might happen upon at least one ingredient for the machine this morning. He was disappointed, however, and soon slunk back into the sheds, where, unsurprisingly, Theo and Otto had gone back to sleep. Guys, aren't you two meant to be finding us somewhere to build this effing time machine?
What?
Oh yes, Otto, wake up! We must begin straight away!
Bugger off! Oh, I've got a hangover.
But you haven't been drinking anything.
Oh, haven't I?
I wouldn't put it past you if you've stolen some booze from... But the three engines were rudely interrupted as a tall man suddenly hurried across the yard, staring at Dave.
Oh, thank goodness. A steamable engine. Right. I need you to... Who are you?
Me? I'm... This... is Rupert. Yes. He is here with us on an educational trip to take in the beautiful atmosphere of this railway.
Huh. I must have missed a memo. Well, nice to meet you, Rupert. I am the manager of the Settle and Carlisle Railway, and I require your help. Could you please head over to the next station? We need a locomotive to doublehead the next train to Leeds. The train is a lot heavier than we had anticipated. Thank you very much!
Rupert! Of all the names in the entire world, and you come up with Rupert? I always wanted a friend called Rupert. Anyway, it won't be for long, Dave. Now, you go pull a train, and for Christ's sake, find some materials. 10 minutes later, he steamed begrudgingly into the station, 10 to 1st, backing down in front of a very worn-out-looking A3 Pacific. As he buffered up, the engine called from behind.
Watch where you're going, you lunatic!
Oh, sorry. Hey, I know who you are.
Well, of course you do. I'm the world-famous Flying Scotsman.
I know that. I just said that I,
the first steam locomotive to top 100 miles per hour.
Actually, I think you'll find that City of Truro...
I, who is the flagship locomotive of the London and North Eastern Railway.
To be replaced by the A4s?
I who?
I was told I was meant to be double-heading this train.
Can't be me, fool. I am the most powerful engine in the world! I don't need a pilot!
Well, you are the only engine here. Scotsman looked around. Indeed, he was.
That's ridiculous! I... really?
Suddenly, the tall man who had addressed Dave in the sheds wandered over.
Mr. Mackenzie, tell this lunatic that I'm perfectly capable of taking this train alone.
Sorry, Scotty, but I doubt you'd manage this train single-handedly over the hills. Rupert here is going to help you today.
Scotsman looked scandalized.
Don't call me Scotty. And I don't need help.
Well, if I say you need it, you need it. Now hurry up and get coupled up, Rupert. The train is due to leave in a moment.
So, Dave was coupled up to Flying Scotsman, who began to mutter under his breath.
I'm going to be late. I'm sure of it. I've never been late before. How they do dare. Making me look incompetent fool!
Shut up! Let's get going! The two engines snorted away from the station, the coachman dragged behind them as they gathered speed, heading out and onto the main line to Leeds, throwing insults at one another as they went. Things went well enough for them, as they thundered through the countryside, ahead of schedule. Ha ha! Looks like we might make good time. Then I can get back to doing my proper job.
Which is what?
Searching for some stuff for my friends.
A scavenger hunt, huh? I love scavenger hunts.
Well, you might be able to help. But can we finish putting this train first? I'll explain once we are back at Carlisle and... Hey, wait a moment! Dave had just spotted something amazing. A farm, sitting in a field not too far away from the line. With an almighty lurch, he applied his emergency brakes, causing Scotsmen to curse loudly as they stopped abruptly.
What the hell do you think you're doing, Rupert?
I think I've stumbled upon something I need. Driver, can you go and see if there are any potatoes over there? As the driver hurried out over to the fields, Scotsman's safety valves lifted.
I swear to God, if we are late, I will personally rip you apart piece by piece.
Calm down, Scotty.
Don't call me Scotty!
I'll get us there, and ahead of schedule, trust me. Oh, look who it is, he laughed, as he spotted Brian rolling up the line. Oh, it's you. What are you doing here? I thought you were protecting Raymond. I'm looking for some diesel fuel for him. We have a plan so he won't cause a paradox. Scotsman was listening closely, and Dave noticed. And in any case, why are you pulling an express, Dave? Brian!
Shh! I thought you said your name was Rupert.
Rupert? That's the best they could come up with. It was Theo and Otto's fault. They started it.
Either you guys are off your trolleys, or something's not right here.
Scotsman, you wouldn't believe us if we told you.
Try me.
Well, if you really must know, it's my nickname.
Nickname?
Yes.
I don't believe you. Something's up here.
Thankfully, Dave's driver returned looking pleased. 10 potatoes, that should do the trick. Excellent. One more step to success.
What?
Oh, nothing. Come on, we don't want to be late, do we? Scotsman pondered for a moment, and Dave and Brian held their breaths, praying that they had not given everything away and therefore caused the ultimate destruction of the world. To their great relief, Scotsman accepted this bizarre situation without further comment. Shall I take the potatoes to the twins? I assume they asked for them. I guess you'd better. I don't know how much longer I'll be out today. Cheers, Brian. So, Dane's driver handed Brian's driver the potatoes. Wondering what on earth potatoes were needed to get them back to their own time, Brian headed off towards Carlisle, while Dave and Scotsman roared away from the scene, picking up speed as they headed to Leeds. Brian was soon rolling peacefully along the line. He had never realised how beautiful and peaceful this railway was. Maybe he would ask Mr. Dark if he could visit here again, if they ever got back to the Dark Railway, and 1963. However, his happy thoughts were interrupted, and the voice of Theo called from a nearby siding.
Psst! Brian! Over here, quickly!
We have found a location for our machine!
Where?
Right here! Brian surveyed the scene. Rusty old sidings.
Isn't it genius? It's not too far from Carlisle, meaning we haven't got a job of travelling from the shed to get here for working.
Right.
Oh, come on! It's an amazing location! Prime real estate!
Whatever you say, guys. Oh, whilst I remember, here are those potatoes. Dave said you needed them?
Oh, yes, we did. Excellent. Thank you, Brian.
What are you doing, anyway? We thought you were protecting our large friend from attack.
Well, I'm looking for some fuel for him. We reckon that if we tell everyone he's an experimental prototype diesel, he can't cause a paradox, right?
Yes, that could work.
As it so happens, there is a large tanker of diesel up in the yard at Carlisle, so you best hurry up and nab it before someone else does.
Be careful, Brian.
I will, he said, as he hurried away, armed with his new information, whilst the twins continued to tinker in the old rusty yard. It was evening by the time Dave and Flying Scotsman returned to Carlisle. The two engines rolled into the shed, looking very pleased with themselves.
10 minutes early! How did we do that?
No idea, but we got there in the end.
Yes! Oh, yes! My spotless record remains spotless! Take that, Gary!
Gary?
Oh, he's an old friend. Don't worry.
Well, I suppose I better get some sleep, he muttered.
Yeah, well. Good night, Rupert.
Good night.
At the other end of the line, Raymond was very pleased to see Brian return that evening.
Oh, Brian! I am glad to see you! I'm dying of thirst here! Well, luckily for me, I found this tanker. Some moron nearly caught me bringing it out of the yard, but I escaped him in the end. Come on, drink up. We'll get searching tomorrow. Then we'll be able to go home. Once Raymond's tanks were full to the brim, the two engines settled down to rest, hoping that Theo and Otto's plan would actually work. Dave awoke the following morning feeling cranky. He clanked out of the sheds, heading out for another search of the nearby yards. He didn't get his hopes up, however, as he was merely searching because he couldn't sleep. And Dave rolled through yet another boring yard, though. He spotted a steam engine ahead of him, rolling purposely up the same track that Dave was on. He called out, "Oi! You there! Get off the line! I was here first and... He suddenly stopped talking, for standing in front of him was himself! The part rendition of Dave stared. "Who are you?" I'm... He suddenly remembered what might happen if he revealed the truth, and immediately tried to prevent it. "I'm Rupert." "You're Dave, right?" "Correct. Now, what do you want? I'm a busy engine." "Well, I was wondering if you know where I could find some electrical cables and neurotoxin." "Neurotoxin? No idea where you find that. As for the electric cables, a large shipment of them is due in today. What do you need them for?"
I need them for some... for a delivery to Manchester this afternoon."
I thought they were coming from Manchester."
Yeah, you see, what I meant to say was... Oh, never mind, get out the way. I've got an important train to take this morning. Good day, Rupert."
Good day." And with that, Dave rolled back to a crossover and allowed his past self to go past. Feeling rather shaky at having a conversation with himself, and wondering if he felt he was going mad, he hurried away to find the twins. Raymond and Brian were soon awake too, and itching to assist the others in the search for parts. Cautiously, they rolled out of their hiding place.
"Are you sure your plan will work?"
"Relax. As long as you tell them you're a prototype, nothing bad can happen."
"I hope so. I just want to get home. I hate it here. I...
But Raymond was suddenly looking out into the wild countryside.
"It's beautiful out here," he said, as the sun rose over the scene. "There's no time to be engrossed in the countryside, Ray. Come on, let's go and meet the others."
About an hour later, they arrived at Carlisle, where Dave, Theo and Otto were waiting.
"Good morning, friends. Nice to see you out and about, Raymond." "Wait, Raymond?"
"Relax, Theodore.
Raymond is a prototype diesel, remember?"
Oh, yes, I remember. Well, we have set up a base just down the line. Hardly any engines go there, apparently, so our project is secret safe. However, there are still several items that we need, including some metal pipes and several fusible plugs. You three, can you try and find them? We shall go and continue working on the machine. We might try and find some other items, but we just don't know. Goodbye."
And the twins rolled away. Dave turned to Raymond.
"They're completely bonkers. I sussed that out a while ago. Do they really think this random assortment of parts will help them build another time teleporter thingy?"
"They seem to think so. They got us here, so they must be able to get us home again. Come on, the sooner we find this rubbish, the better."
After rummaging around in the yards again for some good 3 hours, the engines finally found some items of use. Dave had discovered the train of electricity cables his past self had told him about earlier. Brian located several vans, including some corrugated iron. Raymond, though, felt rather grumpy, for he had found nothing of use.
"Don't worry, Ray. Theo and Otto can find the rest. Come on, guys." Guys? Oh, God, what does he want?"
"What is this?"
he inquired.
"I am not a thing! I am a diesel! Why does nobody understand that?"
Mackenzie was staring at Raymond, bewildered.
"What is this thing, Rupert?"
"This is, he is a prototype diesel locomotive, on trial to see whether British Railways should, make up some sort of modernization plan or some malarkey like that."
"This might be just what I need for the next train. What is your name?"
"Raymond."
"Well, Raymond, can you please take the next service out of Carlisle? the management special to settle, and if they see that I'm using a unique modern design, they might actually allow some decent funding to the line. What do you say?
Oh, fine. But if I do so, can you supply us with some fusible plugs?
Fusible plugs? What for?
I have a very old friend back home in the south, and he needs them desperately.
Alright. If you pull this train for me, I'll look into it for you.
As he walked away, Raymond turned to his friends. Well, there you go. I pull a train, we get some parts with no effort whatsoever. But you have to pull a train in any case. Isn't there effort? I'd rather pull a train and search for junk. See you guys. Dave and Brian collected up the parts they had secured and proceeded down the line, whilst Raymond headed off to Carlisle Station to take Mr. McKenzie's important train.
Right, Otto. We have several parts now. Only a few of the more obscure things to find now. Indeed, Theodore, but where will we find them?
You guys are looking for stuff.
A small blue steam shunter approached the twins. Why, yes, we are.
Maybe I can help.
You? Help us? Unless you can find a gigantic vat of neurotoxin, a pure crystal, several pounds of explosives, and maybe some grapes too, you'll...
Neurotoxin? Crystal? Explosives? I know just the place we can grab that stuff. Of course, I require payment.
Anything, my dear fellow. Where can we find it?
Follow me.
Meanwhile, Raymond's journey had gone well enough. He had managed to impress the managers on the train with his quick acceleration and sure-footedness on the hills. He soon reached Settle, and was glad the journey was over. However, some men had jumped down from the train, and were now chatting happily next to Raymond.
Smashing journey! Certainly wonderful!
This machine! It's incredible!
I've never seen anything like it.
What exactly is it?
Obviously a military experiment.
Or a brand new prototype.
Do we have anything like this in the works, fellas?
No, we do not. We haven't developed anything like this at all yet, but...
But what?
Has anyone got a camera?
You're not thinking.
Yes.
Look, gentlemen, we do not even know who built this locomotive.
Won't this lead to copyright infringement?
Stop being wimps! Gerald, get that camera out! This could change the world!
Alright then, just a few pictures and a quick look around. We could possibly suggest this particular design to the board of directors. Could replicate it, I suppose. Nothing else we've designed works as well as this yet.
Is nobody concerned about who built this prototype and what the implications could be?
No. Come on, fellas, let's have a looky round.
Raymond had no choice but to allow them to swarm around him, and several men had a look in his engine room. Half an hour later, the managers had seen enough, and Raymond finally hauled the train back to Carlisle, where a very content Mr. McKenzie welcomed him.
Thank you very much, Raymond. The managers were impressed. They told me that they could suggest a design like yours to British Railways. Oh, well done indeed.
But...
Oh, yes, your reward. Here it comes now.
The small mogul the engines had met at the beginning of their stay rolled into the platform with several wagons full of steam boiler fusible plugs.
Oh, thank you, Vincent. By the way, you're in charge of the next stopping service, so get back to work.
Right you are, sir, but I'm very exhausted and need a rest.
I gave you an order, Vincent. Do as you're told!
Looking gloomy, Vincent puffed out of the station to find some coaches, whilst Raymond grabbed a train of fusible plugs and hurried away without further comment. During all of this time, Hunter had escorted Theo and Otto to a large yard at the other end of the railway. They snuck into the yard as quietly as they could.
Well, here we are, paradise!
The twins looked around. There was, indeed, various items of interest scattered around the yards.
You two wait here. I'll find those things for you, no problem.
And he zoomed off without a backward glance, going here and there, examining tankers, vans, and wagons in the process. Eventually, he managed to come back to the twins with a large tanker of foul-smelling gas, a gunpowder van, and a small truck full of gravel,
where a small and perfectly formed crystal was just visible on top.
How the hell did you...
I'm a hunter, remember? Engines and people contract me out to find stuff for them. When I say I'll deliver, I mean it.
So this is a...
Vat of neurotoxin, yes!
And that's...
A crystal. There's also the gunpowder you asked for, as well as, believe it or not, some grapes hidden in there.
Oh, Otto! This is almost everything we need! We just need those electricity cables, fusible plugs and corrugated iron, then we should be all set! Thank you ever so much, Hunter! Now, would you like to come back to our hideout for a drink? We have lager, shots, vodka...
Vodka? I love vodka!
Why didn't you say so? Let's roll!
As the three tank engines puffed away with their shipment of stolen goods, two bigger steam engines watched from afar. These two engines were, in fact, the owners of the yard that Theo, Otto and Hunter had just left. They eyed them angrily as they headed off into the sunset.
Are we just going to let them get away with our stuff, Ludo?
Not a chance, Victor. I knew that one. Hunter. We gave him a loan a while back. Remember?
Oh, yes. Yes. He never paid us back. But he will now.
Indeed he shall. I have an idea. Let us follow. Lead the way, Victor.
Hunter, Theo, and Otto soon arrived at the hideout, where an almost completed machine stood. Hunter was awed by it, and soon began asking questions.
So, what is this thing you are building?
It is... something to help us and our friends return home. And thanks to your efforts today, Hunter, we are finally ready to give it a test run. Come, Theodore, let us fit the last of the parts. Despite the lateness of the day, the twins and their drivers set to work assembling the last parts of the machine. Though the drivers and firemen held their breaths as the twins shunted the neurotoxin into place.
Impressive, fellas, impressive,
said Hunter, as the twins rolled back to admire their work. Indeed. Let's give it a test run, Theodore. Theodore! Theo had backed down a little too far and had rolled into a set of buffers. But there were no buffer stops behind him. Instead, Otto and Hunter looked in horror as two 4Fs shunted Theodore quite brutally into another siding where he stopped and moved no more. Theodore! Theodore! Speak to me! But he did not speak. The two engines rolled maliciously towards the two shunters.
Hunter, our slippery friend, found at last.
You shall pay dearly for the day you stole from us.
Not forgetting the debts you still owe us, Hunter.
Hunter? What is this?
You see, Otto, I kind of, well, these guys are loan sharks, and I really needed some money a while back, but I never got round to paying them off.
Enough. We have decided to put you to good use, Hunter. We'll take your little friend too.
What about that one?
Leave him there. A dead engine is no good to us. I want the satisfaction of making these two suffer for their misdeeds. Come, let us leave.
The two engines buffered up to the saddle tanks and hauled them away from the scene as they screamed and screamed for help. It was half an hour before Theo opened his eyes and stared around. The loan sharks were wrong. He was not dead. But his smoke box was pounding and he had a rather large headache. He had, luckily, just been knocked out. Otto? Otto? But Otto was nowhere to be seen. Don't worry, Otto! He called pointlessly. I'm going to save you! Up at Carlisle, Dave, Brian, Raymond, and the little mogul called Vincent were relaxing in the sheds. Flying Scotsman was just finding some alcohol for them to drink, and was due to return any moment now.
I'm so tired.
Wonder where Fear and Otto got to. Probably putting the last pieces of the machine together. Or boozing it up. Speaking of booze, how long will Scotty be?
Probably a moment or two. You know how big-headed he...
Guys! Oh, guys! Come quick! I require your help! Flying Scotsman suddenly rolled over.
I heard someone shouting. Is someone gonna die?
No, Scotsman, no one is going to die.
Someone is going to die unless we get to move on! What are you? We stole some stuff with some loan sharks! They found us! Knocked me out! Captured Otto and Hunter! I think they're gonna destroy them! Who's Hunter? Never mind, Dave! I'm out to rescue my dear Otto!
Wait, did you say loan sharks?
Yes!
LMS4Fs?
I don't bloomin' know! Can we keep a move on to find out?
I happen to know where their secret hideout is. Come on, let's go. I love rescue missions. Come on, engines. Charge!
Scotsman?
Yes, Rupert?
You moved all of 2 foot since you started screaming.
Oh, right. Well, follow me.
And with that, the engine charged off down the line, Scotsman out in front screaming to the heavens, and Theo bringing up the rear, sobbing for his brother to be safe. Well, Otto was safe. For now. Where are we? What happened?
Welcome to our lair.
We have an excellent plan for the efficient disposal of the pair of you, in a way that will both satisfy my sadistic urge to see engines suffer and to earn us enough cash to pay off your debts, Hunter the Shunter.
Yes, you see, we shall slowly melt you both down of your valuable metal parts and convert you into...
Teaspoons?
Teaspoons?
The great British public absolutely love tea, so we thought, why not sell teaspoon to them? We shall be rich by the end of our endeavours. Think how many spoons we can make out of you two.
You're insane! Why can't I just pay you back?
This is a much more interesting way for you to pay your debt. Now, I shall go and heat up the deadly pool of molten lava, ready for the torture to begin.
Hunter! We have to get out of here!
Yes, but how? We have no driver or fireman.
Oh, Theo! Theo! He's dead!
I'm sorry, Otto.
No, you are not! Myself and Theodore have been together since the day we were built. And now I'm without him. I cannot go on. I volunteer myself to be melted down first. Then I can join him in the afterlife. Meanwhile, the other engines had finally come across the loan shark's hideout, thanks to Scotsman's random knowledge of hiding places on this railway. Right, we need to make a plan on how to get in there. I have it covered! And with that, Theo headed off towards the warehouse, grabbing some trucks on the way. He has no idea what he's doing, does he? No idea at all.
Get the door, Victor.
All right, I'm on it.
Good evening. I am a scrap dealer and...
You weren't killed?
What?
You're one of the mugs that stole from us.
No, of course I! But it was no good. Theo was dragged inside the warehouse as Scotsman, Dave, Brian, Raymond and Vincent looked on. Theo was shunted roughly next to Otto, who looked thrilled. Theodore! You're not dead! It'll take a lot more than that to finish me off! Oh, Theodore! I fought!
Enough cozy chit-chat. We are almost ready for the smelting, and now we have the three of them here, Victor.
Indeed. Let the torture begin now. Let us.
What the?
Charge! Oh, I wanted to do that for years!
Scotsman and the others flooded inside, forcing Victor and Ludo into a corner. Come on, guys! We're escaping! You don't say! Get going, then! And with that, the engine blasted back out of the facility. Unfortunately, the loan sharks were right on their tail as they pelted along the line towards Carlisle again. Theo? Otto? Is your flipping machine working now? We think so. Why? I have an idea. Whether it works or not,
Come on, they're catching up!
Now, you shall see what happens when you mess with us.
There is nowhere to hide now.
Don't hurt them!
Eh?
Don't hurt them! Destroy me instead! Raymond was backing down through the machine. He emerged on the other side, apparently weeping. If you want to sell anyone for scrap, take me, not them.
That is very gallant of you, Diesel. We'll take him, Ludo. All that metal could potentially make enough teaspoons to supply the whole of Britain.
Indeed. Seize him!
But, as the two engines rolled together towards the apparently carrying Raymond, he rolled forward suddenly, and two sharks entered the shed that was, in reality, the time machine. You two really are suckers! Goodbye! I think it might be working! But we must check! Throw the switch again!
What happened there?
This is a teleporter, my friends. Able to teleport items through space and time to save money.
Aye. That is to say, we would gladly take this machine and leave. Leave you guys to it.
We'll never bother you again. Oh, Victor. We could make millions with this, and...
Too late! Goodbye! The two locomotives finally disappeared. This time, for good.
Phew, thank God that's over.
So, you guys really are from the future then. And that's a time machine.
I knew there was something weird about you lot!
And so, the day was randomly saved, thanks to a little bit of time travel and a lot of friendship. The end! Nah, it's not over yet. Once everyone had recuperated from their long run to safety, Theo and Otto recalibrated their machine to take the Dark Railway engines back home. I'll go first and see if it works. He rolled into the machine as Otto and Driver threw the small switch. Theodore! Did it work? Perfectly! Come on, everyone! Let's go home! Theo and Otto were the last engine to enter the machine, bading farewell to Flying Scotsman, Vincent, and Hunter as they powered up the machine. Hunter suddenly spoke.
Well, gee, guys, thanks a lot for this adventure. It certainly taught me never to steal again.
It was a pleasure meeting you, Hunter. We wish you the best of luck for the future.
Seeing as you're going there, you could tell me in 10 years' time.
Everyone laughed. Well, we shall see, young Hunter the Shunter. Goodbye, everyone.
Wait.
What?
Can I come with you? I have no real purpose here anymore. I just travel around helping those in need. Please. I'd love to see the future.
Well, we would sure love you to come. But we already have enough Shunters on our railway. Sorry, toodles. And with that, the machine roared to life, as the twins finally disappeared, as unfortunately, the machine began to disintegrate from the amount of teleporting it had been doing, and collapsed in front of the three engines. Back on the Dark Railway, Theo and Otto materialised in the quarry at Soma, where Dave, Brian and Raymond stood, looking a little worse for wear after their time-travelling experience. Oh, Soma! How I love you so! It is good to be home! I hope we're in the correct time period. Hey, you there! What year is it? 1963, you moron! That's good enough for me! Well, we're finally home, guys! What an adventure, eh? Yes, it was very exciting! Exciting? We've caused massive paradoxes, caused so much trouble, and nearly died in the process! How is that exciting?! Beats pulling trains. You do reason well, Otto. But, seriously,
Can you two prompt me something? Anything, Dave? Don't ever show us your technological advances in future. And with that, the trio of friends left Theo and Otto to reflect on their adventure. That was amusing, wasn't it, Otto? Indeed it was, Theodore. But something is bugging me a little. What could that be? What happened to Brain?
Help me! Please! Somebody! Anybody!
Ah! 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 Oh, I give up already.